Alright, so for those of you just tuning in, we're about to spectate a 3v3 on the map MegaRandom between the higher rated viewers, of course part of my weekly Twitch TV live streams. If you want to get in on this, then you can find my live streaming schedule by going to my Twitch page and scrolling underneath the video player there. If you follow me on Facebook and Twitter, you'll also get some updates. In this video, the specific topic is going to be on how you should adapt to the map generation. How do you know what strategy you should pick based off the map selected? Because it is going to vary. From Arabia to Black Forest to Team Islands to Mega Random, a good player is able to adapt to the situation and take his build order and do more than just that. So without further ado, let's jump straight into the game. These players are all actually very good, so I expect to see an excellent game here. And we're doing Mega Random just to see what kind of crazy setup that we can get here and which of these players is capable of going beyond the build. So, in the game itself, we have a very interesting sort of coastal-style map where players start with additional villagers and are housed immediately, so the first thing that should come to your mind is, I need to get unhoused and start building some houses. So, we're going to start off by introducing the players. We have Pantera as the Red Spanish, teaming up with Aoe2, the Yellow Turks, and Kaladin, aka Telemachos, playing as the Teal Mongols. On the opposing team, we have Sci-Fly playing as the Green Mayans, Adam the Rabbit playing as the Purple Berbers, and Ferdy Munch playing as the Gray Indians. So, the game has started out. You are Pantera. You have no vision of the map. What do you do? If you have no idea what it is, especially if you're playing something like Full Random, for example, or particularly Mega Random is when this will be most applicable. Right off the bat, you've noticed that you have a standard distribution of resources. You're looking for your sheep immediately. He has found them. In this case, there are llamas. Now he's going to scout around with the additional ones, trying to keep only two underneath his town center at all times, one being harvested and then one for his villagers to latch onto when they're done with that one. He actually has an additional villager on the llama, but he will be transitioning into the lumber camp right about now. He's scouting around. You have now seen the water. Now the next thing on your to-do list should be exactly what is in the water. Has he scouted anything that's not shorefish? The moment that you see fish that aren't shorefish, then you know that you definitely have to dock here. He's seen, though, that this body of water is not necessarily a super narrow river. It actually is quite deep, so now the thing that should be going through Red's mind is, okay, I need to dock. So, and I'm assuming that's exactly what he's thinking. Right now he's just looking for some deeper sea fish to really be that signal. Yes, it's good to see every player here scouting around, and now we see Sci-Fly with so many villagers on wood, perhaps because he realizes that this is going to be a water map. He's now sending one of his villagers over here, yes, because he's waiting for him to have enough wood to build that dock, and if we check his perspective, he has not seen any deep sea fish, but he has scouted enough of the map that he knows that this is a water map. I don't think anyone else has really seen the edges of the map here, but putting the dock in the middle is going to be more important in general if this happens to be one of those maps where there is a big lake in the middle for map control, because you're able to, you know, raid everybody, and then this is where you expect everybody to dock. Hello, Throttle, welcome to the stream, I'm doing fine. How about you? Good to see you as well, Chris the Wizard. So yes, good to see players scouting around here. We've seen it's a water map. So what does this mean for players? Well, we want that super early dock, so it's great to see that coming out from Sci-Fly here. We want this really early dock, and then our goal here is to make a minimum of approximately 4 fishing ships. Why 4 exactly? We're making 4 fishing ships because 4 is exactly the number of fishing ships that we need to sustain villager production. With 4 fishing ships dropping off 15 food occasionally, you will be able to just pump out your 50 food villagers rather consistently. Why a minimum of... why not more than that? And then that really just depends on what your scouting information tells you. Sci-Fly has seen this fish I can't select because they broke unit selection in HD a long time ago. Look at this guy. Wow. Oh, isn't that just a... There we go. Look, yes. See, he's found the fish snapper. So right now, he knows that there are more than just shore fish here. And then that would be his signal to potentially make more than just 4 fishing ships. 4 fishing ships is generally going to be the minimum, though. If you happen to see only a couple tiles of shore fish, I would say if there are 4 or more tiles of shore fish, then it is sometimes worth docking regardless. Assuming that the body of water is reasonably sized. Rage Match says, how many lumberjacks should you have in wood in the Dark Age if you're on a Navy map? I mean, generally, though, you would still open up with... 4 villagers and wood, and then you would just keep tacking them on, but it really just depends on the map generation. Like, you see, Aoe2 is starting with 4. He could honestly probably have more at this point. You're probably going to end up going all the way up to 12, 14, or even more. Because if you were going for a galley rush, like, you would start with 4, and then, probably work on grabbing the boar and whatnot. If you're going for a galley rush, then once you get to the feudal age, Once you click up to the feudal age, you're going to have zero villagers on food at this point, Rage Master. If you were going for Galley Rush, you want zero villagers on food because you have four fishing ships, the same villager production. Everything should be on wood, and then you'll have like three villagers on gold. So, you know, you might have upwards of like 20 plus lumberjacks. Maybe not exactly 20, because you'll probably want to advance the feudal age pretty quickly. So you have close to 20 lumberjacks. Sci-Fi trying to do some crazy looting action. Thrall says, whoa, 292 viewers, highest without viewbotting. No, I actually used to average like 500 plus viewers regularly. So, no, that's actually pretty low. San Venditti asks, how are your allergies this time of the year? They were really good last week, but this week they're not so great. It just varies from week to week. Yeah. Thank you, Alexia. I love the Mr. Skeletal always. So on a map like this, how would you decide whether or not you wanted to go for a galley rush? Well, it just depends on how large the body of water is, how much fish have you actually seen, and so we'll just swap around various players' perspectives. iVictorious is docked. iVictorious is a little bit more hesitant, though. He's a grizzled veteran Age of Empires 2 player, and he's played enough MegaRandom to know that Tom the Prophet, the guy who made this map, loves to troll people by having them dock on a map where the body of water is much smaller than it seems. It appears to be large, and then you put down the, you know, the dock, and you find out it's actually just a small little patch. So iVictorious is a little bit paranoid here. You know, his dock come down a little bit late. He has significantly fewer villagers on wood than everyone else, and in fact, he's putting down a mining camp as well, so maybe he's going for some sort of watchtowers or, like, castle drop strategy, we'll have to see. So it really just depends on how much water you've seen, but if you are, you know, Sci-Fi or everyone else, and you've done enough scouting, then I think it's your signal here to go for a galley rush. Especially, you know, after you've done enough scouting, you realize that, at least for some of the players here, like, you know, for Ferdy Munch, there's a relatively, like, narrow land passage here, and, you know, you can see, yeah, based off Ferdy Munch's excellent scouting, that this map's sufficiently wallable, you can, and he's doing it right now, you could very easily just go for a galley rush without worrying about dying on the land, so. Adam the Rabbit looks like he's also going for a galley rush. He has three fishing ships, approximately, and yes, he will be, yeah, transitioning heavily onto that. Just trying to claw his way to the feudal age. iVictorious not going for that. Thrall says, wow, never cut any of your 500 plus viewer streams. Last time I was following you was this spring. Yeah, 2016 has not been a good year for Age of Empires 2. My stream is like much, much bigger when African Kingdoms was released. And then, well, as the players start leaving HD, then my stream has shrunk quite a bit. Also, people haven't been, I mean, there was a brief period where people were not particularly supportive of me, like, trying to branch out. So I lost a lot of subscribers doing that. Resinus is trying to have fun playing Hearthstone? Well, screw that guy. But anyway, things are thankfully picking back up. I've noticed that, like, Age of Empires 2 viewership is kind of down in general, besides maybe, like, the Viper specifically. But it's not something that I mind. The most important thing for me is the quality of people here rather than the quantity of them. I'd much rather have a community of 10 particularly awesome people than thousands of just awful man-children. And thankfully, we have one of the best communities on YouTube and Twitch, so who am I to complain? Yeah. Perhaps once, if another DLC ever came out, then the stream would pick back up, but not a huge deal. So anyway, on how to adapt to the map, we've scouted around. Remember, we were scouting, we realized that this was a water map. We realized that there was a particularly large body of water. We didn't just scout, you know, just this little thing and just decide our strategy based off it. No, we walked along the coastline. We realized that this is a large body of water, and we communicated that with our teammate. And we've now decided that the dominant strategy here is going to be some sort of, like, fast feudal age into, you know, galleys, or maybe you're going to go for, you know, fire galleys, for example. So, good to see everybody kind of playing the map very nicely. We've scouted around as well. We know that this is a map that's actually fairly easy to wall based off the distribution of the trees. Ah, wonderful, Throttle. Thank you so much. Since after looking at your Hearthstone stream, I got into it too. It's super fun. Thank you, man. Yeah, I feel with those Zero Empires. Definitely miss them a lot. Well, thank you, Chris. I mean, yes, you guys are absolutely fantastic. Hello, Octobier. Good to see ya. Yeah, the Viper has been very, very popular recently, for sure. Oh, yeah, and Dark Paladin also says correctly when the devs fix numerous bugs of the game. Yeah, I think that the African Kingdoms hype and whatnot was a very big time for me, same with the Forgotten release, but, you know, as people start to realize that Age of Empires 2 HD is, like, you know, even though the expansion is fun, that it's, you know, hampered by 8 months of complete radio silence, no fixes, and then we finally get a patch, and it's not too much. Yeah, that's why the HD community shrunk a little bit, but Voobly's numbers are, like, always, generally always relatively consistent. Anyway, back into the match itself. Everybody here spamming fire galleys, of course, because fire galleys are such a dominant force in African kingdoms. Honestly, it's a unit that's just very difficult to balance. I feel like galley spam got nerfed just a bit too much by the fire galley, but I would like to see some demolition rafts as a way to deal with this, because right now, basically, what we replace the water metagame with is instead of awesome, sick galley micro, which I actually like. I think the galley micro, even though it's repetitive, is extremely skill-intensive and fascinating to watch. We've replaced it with fire galley spam, which is, nothing but the same unit, except it requires very little interesting micro, so I kind of miss the old water metagame. I think the only way to really mix up the water metagame substantially would be to, like, add a ton more ships to the game, and, a bunch of unique ships, perhaps. Generally try to stay out of drama, Frank Michelle. Yeah, I love watching some, like, expert galley micro. Is always very fascinating to watch, but the fire galley is a little bit less on the fascinating side. So right now, again, we've seen this huge body of water. What does this tell us? And we're able to wall on land. This tells us we're going full on the water, because everybody is going to... Ooh, this is going to be a reasonably good demo shot. Nice. This means that we expect everybody to dock and have, a huge chunk of their food economy actually positioned on the water. So, you want to put even more emphasis on it. So that's why I'm glad to see the players are spamming their fire galleys, and now they're adapting by transitioning into demolition rafts. I think it's absolutely excellent. The water here, the body of water is so large that not only do you need it for map control, because if you have this, you have all the fish to yourself. You denied your opponent all the fish because you know everyone's going to dock. And now you have the ability to use transport ships to land things, and you have so much vision. You'll be able to see if your opponents are trying to do anything fancy on land. You'll be able to harass their economies with ships because, again, this is so close to the water. Water is going to be a huge part of this map. Now, I'd be happy to do a follow-up video on this where we showcase some, like, land maps, because it's going to be significantly different if MegaRandom gave us, like, a weird-looking land map. But here, everybody started in the dark, and it's just good to see them adapting to the map generation, realizing that this is going to be a huge water map, and that they're going to need to start spamming some fire ships. Crystal Wizard says, if they just made the game playable, so many people would come back. They don't even need a new expansion, if you ask me. I agree. I think that the big drawback for me, and why I don't play as much AoE as I did before, is that Aoe2 HD was, I think, extremely good for the game, but not exactly what I had in mind. I was hoping for, like a whole new engine, modern networking, something just a little bit more than what we got, because what we got right here was just Age of Empires 2 with shiny water, and a worse performance than Voobly, and missing some Voobly features. HD does have, I think the main selling point for HD are the expansions, but there's nothing HD about them. The expansions are awesome, though. Anyway, back to the game itself. Good demolition shot here. Everybody is reacting appropriately with demolition ships in response to that. I do think that the Viking early water superiority has probably been nerfed a little bit too much, Throttle. Yeah. Nice, stole my coconut. Slayerler says, how often do you have 1v1s on stream videos? I have quite a few of them on my YouTube channel. I encourage you to go check them out. Yeah, Crystal Wizard says, what I never understand is why players don't mass galleys inside their docks to live enough to beat fire ships and have the fletching upgrade. Yeah, that's certainly one thing that they can be doing. It's just the thing is that opening up with fire ships early on is just generally going to be sufficient regardless in African Kingdoms. It really depends, though. If players are making quite a few demo rafts, or if you're able to get at enough galleys, like you said, then you can certainly come out on top there if you micro appropriately. It's worth noting, by the way, if the body of water was this huge, but this map was bizarrely difficult to wall because the forests just didn't really align very well with each other, maybe they were very small, then going for a galley rush is actually very risky. You'll still want to dock regardless and fish, always, if you see a body of water this big. But if the map is really difficult to wall, and you're planning to go for a galley rush, you could very easily die to your opponent just going for a land war. Just deciding that, maybe he's just going to drop some towers on you, archer rush you, maybe he's going to send scouts to your base, and then you have no way to defend against that because you built the galley, you have no food gatherers. In that case, you may have water control, you may have killed a couple of your opponent's fishing ships, but then you just die. So you have to be kind of careful about that, making sure you have a way to defend yourself at home, If you so decide to go for the galley rush in a map like this, where you're not really sure what the layout is. In this case, though, it is certainly appropriate for players to go for a full-out water war, which will be primarily dominated by these fire ships and excellent demo raft micro. I do like that demos are better now, though, because demos do require a lot of skill to utilize effectively. Try and get this shot off. What an excellent timing for a res lag spike. It is now a demolition ship. Oh my god, Telemachus is lagging so hard, his internet is on fire. Will this be a good demolition shot? Everybody on YouTube sweating, Tato sweating uncontrollably. The answer is yes. That was an excellent demolition shot here on the part of the Sci-Fly, so well played. Tamir says, does Boobly have African Kingdoms in the Forgotten Expansions? Yes, they do. They are missing a couple of things. And it's not officially supported by the devs. Smiley says, there's new DLC, how about another naval power that gets free war galley? I mean, yeah, that's one way to do it. Frankly, I think that the way to mix up water combat, though, is not necessarily to overbuff fire ships. It's not like fire ships are OP, it's more like fire galleys are a little bit crazy. It's just tricky to get it correct, man. Very tricky. I think one of the ways to mix it up would just be to give Aztecs demolition rafts, and then to give Vikings fire galleys, that way they feel fair. And maybe just to add more ships. I feel like the game just needs more ships, because right now it's really just three ships. So, very tricky to balance that. Sailor says, the last 1v1 I found on your YouTube channel was a couple months ago. I've already watched that one. We'll do some future 1v1, Slayer Lord. Thank you for the reminder. Yeah, I have a lot of them on the YouTube channel. Like, I'm not sure if you've seen all of them, but I have a lot. However, I could certainly do more. So just remind me in the future as... Did anyone see that? Can I see that? That's some Uncanny Valley stuff right there. That was a little disturbing. Anyway... Like I said, you know, you focus fully on the water, and then Ferdy Munch is going to punish you. He's going to moonwalk his way in here, as the Indians, with a forward siege workshop. He's noted, by the way, this is an excellent play on his part, because he notices that his team has, like, fully secured water control, so why waste time making more boats? These guys should stop making ships, and it's good to see, I think, that they've stopped now. You've got water control. You don't need to make any more boats. And another advantage of war galleys, by the way, is that, and I like these mixing a couple of them, is that you're actually able to apply some offensive pressure on land, you know, raids and villagers. Fire galleys do not offer that. And now he's just going for land. And, you know, every player in this game was, you know, relatively committed to their navy, so he's going to have a lot of difficulty defending against this. We'll see if Pantera is able to hold the line. Meanwhile, on the bottom side of the map, Aoe2 is coming in here with some Janissaries. This is one of the reasons why we saw him going so very heavily on stone. He's realized now, climbing his way back in the water... Yeah, once you lose it, like, without a castle, some bombard cannons, onagers, and bombard towers can be really tricky to do so might as well just go straight for the land. This is more true when you've lost the water than if you've won it, that you should just go for the land and just try and kill your opponents here. Because here they have a huge, huge, huge navy, so hopefully you'll be able to catch him off guard, and it looks like that might be happening. Green is a colossal score, by the way. Yellow is very low, and he's going to be putting out a second castle. I like that he was scouting with the outpost initially, just to make sure that his Operation Aoe2, was unseen. Sneaking in here with these Janissaries. Green's gonna take so much economic damage, but Purple here, being a good teammate, this is how we can tell that these players are actually high elo. Because they look at the map and help the team. He's has a siege workshop here, he's actually spamming a bunch of battering rams. He's gonna need quite a few to deal with this castle. I actually think I would be making mangonels here to deal with the Janissaries. Chainsaw says, balancing with only 3 units is hard. I'd add more ships. Completely agree. I just think they need more ships. Caraville Master Silver Green, I think, is decent. Kind of like a sea scorpion. Not the animal, like the siege weapon in the game. I like this forward castle here as well. Not exactly sure why that's here. I think it's an okay unit. But it's not something that I've honestly had that much time to play with, because they don't match up that well. Like, you kind of have to mass them up a lot, and if your opponent... has a lot of fire galleys, which they just tend to, or fire ships, then they're not so great. They seem okay. See the Fury. Yeah. Water wars are generally decided before the Imperial Age, and then once you have control of the water, the cannon galleons here are just going to totally win the game, sieging these guys along the coastline. So, really where most of the action is going to take place is going to be with Aoe2. Can he make enough of a difference here, and can Red hold on? Red being raided by these camels, what do you do if you're in Red situation? Pikemen, so I like that he is making some of them, because we're at the stage of the game where he's okay making that sacrifice in his economy. Ray mixing in some siege weapons, apply some pressure here. Moving in on Red's economy. How will Teal deal with this? He's going to put down a defensive castle. This is going to be so awkward for all these players because they put so much of their food economy in fishing ships on the water, and that's why it's interesting to see that Teal's actually docked along the edges of the map, because really, no one else is taking advantage of that. In fact, only the Teal, Red, and Yellow team have actually docked along the edges, so maybe this is a way to bolster their economy. Use the wood they have stockpiled and get back into it. Dark Paladin says, suggest a privateer ship similar to a monk converts enemy ships. Yeah, that could be interesting. I would like to see, you know, just a wide variety of ships. The thing is in the Castle Age, when your opponent is spamming castles on you, you actually need a significant amount of battering rams to be able to deal with that. So, you know, he's making four here, which is generally going to be sufficient. And actually, this could be huge! I think the castle just got deleted by Avictorious, fully recognizing that it would be very difficult for him to actually finish that in time. This is excellent on the part of Adam the Rabbit. Did actually force that castle to be deleted, and yes, construction will resume at the back. I think Ham Cannoneers have like a very small attack bonus versus batting rams. And he's applying some good pressure here. Now he just has to retask these battering rams, but he's got so much that he has to worry about because the Janissaries are in here. Can Aoe2 carry this game? Where's the heroic music when you need it? Shooting these houses. He's really going to need to, you know, move these units around, just do some raiding, but he's got so much he has to manage right now. On the Rabbit trying to mass up some Camel Archers to defend himself. Meanwhile, Red responding immaculately to this forward aggression by putting down defensive castle. We'll kind of put a wrench in those plans as Gray is no longer able to push in here, so. Defensive castle is one of the great ways to stop a push if you really need to defend yourself in the Castle Age, because your opponent needs to spam so many battering rams to get through that. Once you get to the Imperial Age, though, trebuchets are going to be the ultimate stall breaker. So now, if you're Gray, you've done plenty of economic damage. I think it's actually time to just sit back, relax, get to the Imperial Age, build a trebuchet, and then recontinue the pressure. Welcome, Jack-O-Lantern. This is actually not Nomad. This is Mega Random. Good to see you, my friend. Rage Master says, as the Indians, would you use elephant archers in your army or Imperial camels flat out better? Again, different units for different situations. One of them is ranged, one of them has a million HP, one of them is a cavalry counter, one of them is just a super tanky, slow cavalry archer. Different units for different situations. Much like the War Elephants versus Paladins thing, Imperial camels are generally going to be more useful because they're cheaper, but elephant archers are so strong if you can actually mass them up. But they're useful in different situations. If your opponent's massing a bunch of cavalry units, then yes, Imperial camels are the way to go if you want to do some raiding. Elephant archers are not a raiding unit, they're really slow. They're better against, like, melee units. Even ranged units, yeah. But, like, basically things that aren't cavalry. Opponents are spamming siege onagers. Make some Imperial camels. Looks like green gonna do some aggressive landing action. So this is actually very interesting. He's able to hold the line here, sacrificing a big chunk of his base. And this is a very aggressive play, but an excellent one, too. Something I think we can learn from. When your opponent is forwarding you aggressively, and we saw this a bit in the last game, when you have several castles in your opponent's base, that means that he probably has no defenses at all at home, so if you manage to somehow sneak some units into his economy to go raid him, then you can actually just win the game outright. So, Sci-Fly, our green Mayans player, gonna make a big play here. Aoe2 needs to build this castle. He wants to. Where are the villagers that he needs to build it, and will it go up unseen by green? Green might not have seen this castle. If this castle can go up, then Aoe2 will be totally fine. He's like, no way to actually get Janissaries back in his own base without a transport ship. Disaster! Meanwhile, the battering rams, Adam the Rabbit trying his best to stop this push, but really, what Adam is doing here is just trying to buy time. I think I would have made a few defensive mangonels instead of the battering rams, but honestly, he forced that castle back, so it really did work out in favor of Adam. So, well played on his part. Some of these Janissaries will die here for free. I feel like Aoe2 has not applied sufficient pressure here, but he's trying his best. Meanwhile, Telemachos, our Teal Mongols player, trying to defend with some Mangadai, but Mangadai do get countered by these camels, especially when the camels have all these upgrades. It takes so long for the Mongols to really just get going as a civilization. Right now, it's just going to come down to some good micro, but this is Aoe2 HD we're talking about. This will be kind of tricky. He's trying to, you know, kite these guys underneath the town centers, so good control on the part of Teal. And now we're kind of on a stalemate in the top side of the map. Gray is not really able to apply too much more pressure than he has been already. Siege Workshop coming down here, so Green thinks that he can apply the killing blow, trade a base for a base. This is bold, but I absolutely love it. Yellow has no gold income at all, actually, because this is where his gold mine was, and the gold mines are all at the front of his base. Disastrous map generation on him. On his part, and now Green gonna move some plumed archers in. He's gonna see his castle for the first time, be a little bit surprised. Gonna slow him down. Meanwhile, I think Yellow is about to peter out entirely in his aggression. This team is looking like they're in deep, deep trouble. This is a significant amount of Berber camel archers have an attack bonus versus other cavalry archers. The thing is though, is that iVictorious is not able to sustain Janissary production anymore without any access to gold. He is going to intelligently try to stonewall this off, which is a good choice, but plumed archers will just run around it. And as soon as they find this gold mine, he's in deep, deep trouble. He's going to put down a town center here. Slayerlord says, wasn't trying to force more 1v1s, just curious. Oh, thank you so much, Slayerlord. He says, I'll still watch and enjoy your videos, including other games. Well, I appreciate it, especially for those of you who take the time to support the non-Age of Empires stuff. Helps the channel out a lot, so thank you. Means I get to stick around on YouTube. That said, Slayerlord, by all means, don't feel like you're forcing me to do more 1v1s. If anything, it just reminds me I should be. I should mix them in every now and then. It has been a little longer than I thought it had been. So, yeah, I was going to do that regardless, so we'll do some of that. Feel free to remind me in the future. We'll do like a 1v1 maybe next week or something. Ah, absolute disaster for iVictorious. He was making such a huge play, but alas, difficult for him to deal two players at the same time. Basically, what iVictorious is banking on right now is just bleed slow. And we'll see if he's able to bleed slowly enough. Can he cauterize the wound? Prevent him from losing additional limbs. Looks like Gray's gonna make a really aggressive push up here. He is actually in the Imperial Age, so really, like, he just needs to make sure that the teal and red are able to come out on top here, and I don't know what that noise was. Neighbors or something like that. So teal and red need to be able to beat gray, because right now this is a 2v1 situation, so gray should not be able to posture up here aggressively. Thank you so much, Uger Iceman. I don't know if I'll implement video donations. It's up to people, but, I'll think about it, man. Maybe if I set a pretty high requirement. What do you guys think about that? Yeah, Malgrabi Camels is still bugged, where it affects all players in the game. So yeah, so teal basically just needs to come in here with red and kill gray, because right now there's a 2v1 over here. iVictorious is 2v1. Like, this happens all the time in competitive Age of Empires 2, where one flank is getting 2v1, the other one is getting 2v1, so really they just need to be able to win their own double player side. Because yeah, Adam the Rabbit, he's done with this. He's going to lose a lot of his guys for free here. I thought I got a donation because someone advanced the Imperial Age, but I did not. Hey, Turius, just trying to stall. The Plumed Archers have really just been really obnoxious, and it looks like Sci-Fi managed to actually kill off one of those town centers as well. I think it's so smart, I can't stress this enough, so smart for Telemachos, our teal Mongols player, to actually dock again on the edges of the map where no one is going to be able to punish him. That's a great way to just build up his economy. Look how many farms he has. Zero. That's right, absolutely nothing. He has zero farmers. How many fishing ships does he actually have? Wow, he has 31 active fishing ships. Absolutely fantastic. And now he's up to the Imperial Age. Mongols are slow to get going in the early Imperial Age, but he's got the Elite Magadite upgrade. He has Bracer. He has Chem. I think he's ready to go. They need to kill Gray. But I have to say, this is an awkward Civ matchup. It's not like a hard counter or anything, but the Indians, since they have very strong camels, are something that the Mongols do have to watch out for, and also disincentivizes Conquistador production from our Red Spanish player. It can be quite difficult to deal with. These units are very resilient, very strong counters to Megadite. Like, even Megadite don't do very well versus the Elfin Archer because they have so much health. And Yellow's just losing castles. He's only lost one. Did a lot of damage to green. If he can build up his own base, he might be okay. This game is not over yet. Yellow just has to be able to build up his economy because he's really just lost so much of it. Oh, so much of it. I don't think Malgrabi Camels was supposed to be a team-based tech, but that would be interesting, NJ Gamer. I mean, if it applied to its entire team, that could be very fascinating. Good to see you, Imperium78. Welcome to the live stream. Happy to have you. So, Red with a bunch of trebuchets. Gray's Reign of Terror ends here. He will have to start backing up production. I like, by the way, that, you know, Gray and Yellow have been so far deep into the opposing bases. This gives them plenty of time, plenty of ground to lose. You generally don't want to be the guy, like, defending yourself in your own base. You don't want the front line to be way far away from your economy. Because here, with Red, there's just a lot of collateral damage here, where just a bunch of his villagers end up dying because they're just too close to the battlefield. We saw this in the Black Forest game that I casted relatively recently. Black Forest economy tips strategy. Definitely recommend you guys check that one out. That it is good to see that Gray actually has the battle line up here, Because he has just so much stuff to lose. It's going to take a long time for Red and Teal to be able to push into his own base and do some real damage. Same thing with Yellow, you know, he's deep inside Green's base, and Yellow did lose another castle, but he is moving forward here, managing to snipe off a couple of Trebs. He's losing his Janissaries because they're just a bit too far forward. Bracer technology out from Purple has to stop losing these Janissaries. Oh my god. But he's killing a lot of villagers, though. We'll slow down Green, stem the bleeding a little bit. Green, though, is up in the Imperial Age, and we're going to start flooding with Elite Eagle Warriors, which are so much stronger in the early Imperial Age before your opponent is able to field out the appropriate counter units. Elite Eagle Warriors are just so strong. The upgrades are actually not that expensive for them, and you just start flooding them before your opponent has, like, a ton of defensive castles, a ton of champions, tons of paladins. And they do also flood out there pretty quickly. No Eldorado for Green, but he doesn't really need it to, you know, do some damage here. Meanwhile, Teal's just trying to carry the game, and his score is huge. Can he do it? Fully upgraded Elite Mangadai for him. This unit is so very strong to spam. Imperial Camel's out for Gray. Interesting. Red moving the line of Trebs forward, trying to recover his economy, because honestly, he's taken so much damage, because the battle line has just been in his base. He might need to build an additional town center, honestly. His pop's a little low. Meanwhile, I'm the Rabbit making a huge play here. This is what I was talking about earlier on in the game, why adapting the map here was so important. And it's just great to see Purple here taking advantage of all the map control he has. It's something that I don't often see players do too often. When you're in a situation where you can afford to do this, because this side of the map is going okay, and this side of the map is going okay, you can actually afford to make a, you know, pretty big play, which is transport your villagers all the way over here, build a forward, and just go straight for the throat, because again, he wants to make sure that Teal doesn't get too out of control. The Mongol's such a late-game powerhouse. We also don't want to give Red too much space to rebuild, because he is a scary good player, so we want to make sure that we keep him down. This is interesting, very risky. He has a couple of villagers here. Sometimes you see new players only bring like one villager forward if you're trying something crazy like this. You need to bring a couple, otherwise this castle will never go up. Now he's going to try and do some heavy raiding. This is not designed to kill, this is designed to maim. So, in this case, he's expecting to lose his forward at some point, but hopefully this is enough to distract his opponent and mean that Gray will be able to kind of hold the line here. Red inching line forward here with this castle, because he knows Gray really has no Treb support here. Just trying to make sure that Gray doesn't really get to mass up any units. Meanwhile, Teal backing him up. Great unit control on their part. Trebline moving forward. Red has, like, very few actual military units, though. And Camel Archers are a great choice. It's good to actually see them coming into play as one of the ways to deal with Elite Mangadai. I keep forgetting that the Berbers can do more than make knights. Can you believe it? Usually in my, like, counter videos, where I talk about unit counters, I don't list the new units that much because, we don't see them coming into play as much, and a lot of people still play on 1.0C, but yeah, the Camel Archer is a great way to deal with Mangadai as well as the Genitour unit as well. So A2S, where is Rez from? I am from the United States, California. Well, can Teal carry this game? Because it looks like, you know, Yellow has lost his last castle. I think it is correct for them, to, by the way, for Adam to just try and kill the castles and deal with these units later. Elite Camel Archers will slowly be able to pick off these Janissaries. Here comes the Mangonel. Yellow's done so much damage to Green, but he has to be able to build back himself. Alright, these Eagle Warriors are finally down. Will the Mangonel do it? It doesn't really matter at this point because Green has plenty of plumes. This is a decent Mangonel shot for sure. You can see the extra 44 HP here coming into play. Well, it looks like Purple will be losing this castle as we expected due to the trebuchets. There's no way he can actually defend this, but it's really just a buy time. Buy his team enough time so that they can clear iVictorious out of Sci-Fly's base, and then, you know, start really putting the pressure on him. Some of the garrison inside this castle presumably just plumed archers. We can go swap back to double check. Are there any Trebs petards? Nope. But it looks like, though, Green will start docking, and this is when things get really dicey. Hello, Carry4, great to see you. A little late, but it's okay. If you follow me on Facebook and Twitter, you will get updates on when I'm streaming next. I'm trying to use those more often. Also schedules below, but I'm assuming it's more of a time zone thing or you were busy. But regardless, it looks like he's going to be making some galleons. This is going to be devastating for Teal, Red, and Yellow. As, remember, we said like 31 fishing ships or something like that for Teal. So these galleons are going to be great. I think he realized that, you know, when, yeah, so.